So people have been studying starfish larvae for almost 200 years. The reason for that is that starfish larvae were seen as sort of one of the first cases in animal evolution where the development of a juvenile or intermediate form with a sort of developmental plan that's qualitatively different from that of the adult. So in animal evolution, starfish are important because they're one of the first cases where you see the emergence of the biphasic life cycle. And in this case, the idea is that starfish themselves, they live on the bottom of the ocean, they aren't that motile, so they adapt to this ability to have this freely swimming larval stage in order to disperse and find favorable habitats. So a lot of these early biologists studied invertebrate larvae as sort of a canonical example of how you have a biphasic life cycle. So we were very interested in this because the entire point of having larvae for a starfish is so you have a swimming form, so you get the advantages of swimming. And so when we looked at them, we saw them in our lab, looked at them in the petri dish, we noticed that there was a lot of sort of intricacies in the way that they swim. So these are all very small, they're all less than a millimeter long. But you can see they're capable of quite a bit of complexity in the way that they swim. You can see that they sort of have this smooth motion through the water, but they also do barrel rolls when they bump into each other. You can actually see that one will actually back up and go the other direction. So in other words, there's quite a bit of complexity for this very simple larval form. And we're very interested in understanding how this happens. But when we tried to study them, we tried to do sort of the simplest possible fluid characterization experiment to see what the actual flow fields look like, we noticed that the flow field did a lot of things we weren't expecting to see. So what we did here is we took a single larvae, we put it on our microscope slide so it was fixed, and then we just put beads in the water. Then we're imaging what the beads do just using a sliding maximum intensity projection technique so you can see what the path lines are as a function of time. And one thing that really strikes us about this is that these are low Reynolds number swimmers, meaning that in order to create this vorticity, they're continuously expending power into the fluid. So to us, it suggests that this is very much a deliberate adaptation, that this isn't just sort of an accidental vorticity. So we're very interested in understanding how this can happen. Moreover, if you look carefully at this video, you know, we've watched this hundreds of times, we've seen all these little details, but one of the things that's really striking is in addition to having this sort of canonical stationary flow field, you have this large dipole on top with all these small vortices on the sides. You can see that the small vortices, they actually have some of them have opposite handedness, and they'll actually merge together and then split apart over time. So there's some sort of annihilation process happening. Moreover, if you look at other topological features, such as the stagnation, the hyperbolic stagnation points that occur when two of these vortices intersect, you can actually see that the larvae can kind of move around these points as time varies. This is about a 3-minute video that we sped up, and so these are very slow varying phenomena. So we were interested in figuring out sort of why and how these larvae would have adapted the ability to make up this complex of flow field at low Reynolds number. So the way that they make it is pretty well known, which is that like a lot of other invertebrates, starfish larvae have evolved this structure called ciliary bands. So I think most of us are pretty familiar with cilia, and these little cells that have this hair that pushes water past the surface. But starfish larvae are unique because they have hundreds of thousands and sometimes even millions of these cells concentrated in a thin band that outlines the periphery of the animal. The reason that's important is because by having this one-dimensional structure, they can actually have a single band of neurons that travels along this ciliary band and allows them to control different parts of it. You can think of it as sort of a precursor to the evolution of the spinal cord. And so the idea is that they've developed this kind of adaptation in order to get very fine-grained control over how different parts of this band be. And so when you think of it this way, it becomes clear sort of what the fundamental mechanism for creating vorticity is, which is, here we've zoomed in on a portion of the band, so you can see this. If you have a band with a control mechanism that allows you to address different parts of it separately, you have a boundary condition that you can essentially program using your nervous system. So here you have sort of this overall flow where a lot of the cilia are kind of being told to be in one direction, but you have a single patch that has an opposite beat direction. And so that, when you have that, your boundary condition changes, that it has a discontinuity in the sign, and it causes streamlines to lift off the surface and form that vortex in the middle of the image. What's really cool is that because this is sort of a continuous band, if you zoom in on just those two points where the tangential component of the velocity changes sign, you see features that we're calling topological defects, and this is the local thrust vector has a discontinuity in one dimension. And this is cool because this is very much sort of solving a physics problem as opposed to having your boundary condition change, but it manifests as a very well-identified physiological feature that you can repeatedly find across different animals. So once we saw that, we realized that the cilia was very much sort of this advanced control mechanism that these larvae have developed. We were very interested in figuring out why these animals would go through all this trouble of developing this adaptation. And so we did a variation of our experiment where we put beads in the water as before, but then we also added motile algae to the water. We know that the starfish eat motile algae. And so you can see the algae are kind of the larger particles. They have these helical trajectories that they trace out as they swim. And so the farfalle, they swim through this random block-like behavior. But you can see once they get close to the vortex regions, these high-speed recirculation regions, they actually get entrained because the local flow field is on the order of hundreds of microns per second, and these algae can only swim around like 50 microns per second at the most. So in other words, there appears to be some sort of whirlpool-based capture mechanism happening at low Reynolds number that's entraining these swimming particles near the surface of the puddle larvae. So that suggests that these are somehow a trapping mechanism. But then to confirm that this had really did have something to do with feeding, we looked at their data a little bit more closely. You know, when we do our experiments over really long amounts of time, you can actually see that these particles build up inside the gut of the animal. So that's the stomach of the larvae. And so once we saw that, we knew those particles had to be going from sort of the far field into the actual larvae at some point. So after exhaustive searching, we found that sort of, if you wash a single portion of the ciliary band long enough, you'll see that these particles that are sort of being carried along these streamlines, once they get close enough that they actually touch the cilia can actually sense that the particles are there, and they lock down and grab the particle out of the flow. So in other words, we have this advection mechanism, but once you have particles that pass close enough to be intercepted, then they'll actually get ingested by the larvae. So this is interesting to us. This is just that there's a couple of crossings that work. There's sort of an interception feeding mechanism that's driven by some sort of active boundary condition on the surface. So we tried to put together sort of a simple model of how this could be happening, sort of how the feeding mechanism works. In order to do that, we relied on sort of the classic scorer model, which several people in the session have talked about already. The idea is that we're going to approximate our star, which is a circle, and we're going to say that there's some complex boundary condition that we're going to map onto some sort of series of sign changes. And the idea of the square model is that if you only have a first-order Fourier mode in the boundary actuation, then you'll never have vorticity because you just have a streaming flow past the surface. But if you have higher-order modes superimposed on the boundary's integral velocity component, then you get local reversal regions, which are sort of what drive the formation of vorticity patches. So the idea is that we want to create a space of models based upon the idea that if you add higher and higher levels of control on the surface, or higher and higher levels of spatial resolution, then you'll have more and more vorticity at different length scales. So we can use the score model to conduct simulations of how different numbers of vortices capture particles. And what we see is that generally if you add vortices to the score model, then a given blind source of particles will be passively vected towards the surface, but a greater and greater fraction of particles will pass close enough to the surface to be intercepted. What that means is that essentially adding vortices to the score model compresses streamlines that would be evenly spaced in the far field into close enough to the surface to be intercepted by the larvae. And this trend is strong that it scales sort of, we can rescale by the interception distance and other simulation parameters. So there's this sort of geometric effect at work that causes vortices to enhance your feeding rate. But when you do that, you're always taking parts of your ciliary band and allocating away from creating a streaming flow past the surface, causing a decrease in the swimming speed. So for a fixed ciliary band, we have what we call a feeding-swimming trade-off, insofar as creation of vorticity to bring particles near your surface always will decrease your swimming speed. So once we knew that there were these kind of factors at play in creating this sort of geometric capture mechanism, we want to use it to actually understand some other features of our data. So in a couple of our videos, we started to see that they actually can change their flow fields over time. So in this video, you see there's sort of four vortices, but it blinks transiently to having six vortices near the edges. And if you watch this video long enough, you see that the number of vortices changes quite a bit as the time evolves. It suggested to us that there might be some sort of mixed strategy at work because they have this neural mechanism that allows them to change the number of vortices on their surface. And so what we did is we took a data set like this, we ran PIV on it to get the velocity field, and then we tried to reconstruct the flow field as a function of time by fitting it to the square model using least squares. And of course, we pay some penalties with the geometric effects. We can actually do pretty well in some parts we qualitatively reconstruct the key features of the flow field just using the square model, just using the first 10 nodes in the square model. And so when we plot that as a function of time, so these are just the first 5 nodes plot as a function of time across the entire video gesture, we can actually see that there's these sort of key regions in the behavior where you have regions where the first order mode, one that generates the streaming flow past the surface, we have these regions where that's very high, so you get this large dipole flow field. But then when it sort of pauses and we don't see this large dipole, then you see that other nodes in the square model dominate the system. So in other words, there seems to be some sort of mixed strategy present in the larvae. We were interested in this because it suggests that there's some sort of low-dimensional behavior that you can parameterize the behavior of these animals in terms of just a finite number of nodes in the square model. And so our next sort of set of things we want to work on is trying to sort of generalize this work to understanding some of the general evolutionary biology that these 18th century people were working on. The goal is to see there's some sort of general set of biomechanical principles that underlie the early morphological evolution of the vertebrates. So with that, I'll go ahead and take any questions. So we don't have really clean data on this yet, but it seems like it's known that they seek out patches of algae because there's these microbes in the ocean. And there's sort of really old experiments that people have noticed that they tend to sort of seek out these patches and slow down and linger there. No one has actually imaged to see whether they increase the porosity and generation at that point, but we speculate that that would be some sort of chemical trigger that they're picking up. There's a couple of things, which is these aren't strictly absorptive feeders, right? So there's this sort of processing time once you pass through the surface, meaning that's not like a first passage time problem where you touch the surface and you're consumed. So we expect this sort of delay time in the interception to add this sort of time scale trade-off, because that makes it on the time scale of the problem. There's also this sort of heterogeneity issue, which is that if you can modulate your behavior, it makes sense to sort of increase your cross-section at a high density region, which is something you can do without sort of any other trade-offs associated.
Does the fibroblastic decay changes with the number of the vertebrates?
Yeah, so each mode has a characteristic die-off, so the only one that doesn't go to zero infinity is that first row of vision or swimming. But you do have sort of this clear hierarchy in the length scales associated with different numbers of vortices. And so that's why, like in the video of the switching, you see that like it sort of goes very dark whenever there's no swimming mode, because those near-field vortices decay really quickly, like one over 106.